Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2024. We've got no apologies this morning and Fulton McGregor is joining us online. So our first agenda item is to consider whether to take agenda item 4 in private to discuss the evidence we will hear this morning. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So our main item of business today is to consider the proposals for an early release of prisoners and other key challenges in Scotland's prisons. So this is a preparatory session for next week's appearance by the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Prisons Service. So I welcome our first panel of witnesses to today's meeting. So Professor Sarah Armstrong, Professor of Criminology at the University of Glasgow, Kate Wallace, Chief Executive of Victim Support Scotland, and Lindsay Smith, Chair of the Justice Standing Committee with Social Work Scotland. So thank you all for agreeing to provide evidence to the committee today. And I refer members to paper 1. So I'd also like to thank Families Outside and Howard League Scotland for their written submissions. These have been very helpful. So I intend to allow around about 60 minutes for this session. And I'll begin with a general opening question for our panel members, and I'll perhaps work from left. So I'll bring in Professor Armstrong first, and then I'll work across the panel. So the Cabinet Secretary, as you know, is proposing that we release up to 550 prisoners earlier than anticipated because of an emergency situation, and she's also proposing other measures later on via new primary legislation to cover long-term prisoners. So I'd just like to ask, in general terms, what are your views on these proposals? Do you think this will be enough, or should an alternative way forward be found, particularly in the context of this sort of longer-term approach? So I'll bring in Sarah first of all.
Thanks very much, convener. So the proposals are being phrased as emergency releases, and you know, do we need the releases? As I would say, my research most recently is concerned with deaths in custody and the impacts of those on families, and I would say the prisons right now are not safe, that the level of deaths has been going up quite considerably, that began in 2019 and was amplified during the pandemic and continues. So prisons are not safe to the extent that you're reducing population so that you're creating a greater amount of safety for people in prison, both working and living there. I would think that some kind of measure, urgent measure, is needed. Will reducing the prison population by 500 in a fairly rapid way have any longer-term impacts? I doubt it. I think when the emergency releases happened during COVID, we saw the prison population go back up and actually increase at a faster rate after those releases. So it's very much a sort of safety valve measure. And so I would very much agree with your suggestion that longer-term measures need to be made. And I can certainly talk about those, but in some ways, I think those longer-term measures have as much to do with other parts of the criminal justice system as with the prisons. It has to do with the police and the kinds of arrests they're making. It has to do with the Crown and the routine opposition to bail. It has to do with the courts and the way we sentence and the way sentences have become ever more punitive, and there's reduced the incentives for sentences to be a process of building hope and rehabilitation. And it has to do with the parole board, which continues to have an extremely low release rate or recommendation for release rate. So all of those things are factors which are playing into the reason that Scotland has a criminal justice population that is so way out of proportion with its neighbors of a similar crime and population profile, 2 to 3 times more than Ireland or Finland or Norway or Denmark. There's no reason for it. And I think what we are seeing in looking at deaths in custody is that Scotland, as far as I can find in the records, has more drug deaths in prison proportionately than any other prison system that produces records on this. So what it looks like to me as a criminologist is that we're using a very expensive criminal justice system as a primary means of addressing a drug problem, but badly, and that's creating safety issues for everybody who's inside that system.
Thank you. That's a really helpful introduction, just to set the scene a little bit. And I know that members will come back to that longer-term sort of systematic approach that we need to look at in and around this. Kate Wallace, basically the same question to you, which is, you know, do you think that the measures that are being proposed, both in the short term and are effective, and sort of your initial comments around the sort of longer term approach?
So we would agree that they're not a long-term solution to this. We have grave concerns about the approach that's being taken. We think it will result in more victims. We saw that the last time during COVID, as has just been explained, where you know, we saw within a six-month period over 40% had reoffended who'd been subject to emergency release. So we have got grave concerns. You know, like the previous speaker, we do not think that this is a long-term measure, and we are, you know, well aware of the high levels of anxiety that the announcement has caused for victims, many unnecessarily. But yeah, it's resulted in increased calls to our helpline, our services, and I know that other organisations have faced that too. What we had hoped for was safety planning and risk planning for victims and support planning to run alongside release, but the timescales that are being discussed and the approach that's been taken is not going to allow for that this time round.
Just on that then, I wonder, can I ask a sort of follow-up question? You may be aware of some correspondence that the committee received from the Cabinet Secretary just outlining the sort of proposed kind of plan for the release process, and within that she makes reference to prescribed organisations that would have a role in and around obviously supporting victims in relation to the release of prisoners, and obviously victim support is one of them, along with other ones. Does that reassure you that that is sufficient, or from what you've said just a moment ago, it sounds as though you've got some concerns about whether that would be adequate?
It won't. I mean, it won't be adequate, certainly not this time round. What there is an information sharing agreement being worked on with Scottish Prison Service and organisations that are named within the secondary legislation. However, that I've not even seen a draft of that yet. And given that the timescales that we're talking about, also victims will have to come forward. The onus will again be on them to come forward, raise concerns that they have. We will then have to request from the Prison Service acknowledgement of whether or not the person, the prisoner in that case, is a named person on the list for emergency release. And all of that is going to be, you know, so close to the wire in terms of when prisoners are due for release that, you know, I think that we need to be realistic. Any ability to do any real, you know, do any meaningful safety planning or support planning is not going to be achievable this time round. And I'm pretty disappointed given the lessons that we said we would learn from the last time.
Okay, thank you for that. Lindsay, I'll bring you in now.
So I would agree on the first question that I think it's necessary. I think it's not going to resolve the long-term issue of the prison population, but I think it's necessary at the moment to buy us some time. Reading through the papers, it's well documented the impact the prison population is currently having on prisoners and on staff working within the Scottish Prison Service. I absolutely welcome the other proposals that have been put forward at the moment in relation to HDC and considering how to work with long-term prisoners. But we have mentioned, and Kate's mentioned there, we have learning from COVID. We enacted emergency provisions there to release prisoners early. for me, there's a marked difference this time round. We're not living in a COVID society, so a lot of folk who were, we did have a high return to custody from that cohort, but we were dealing with really severe restrictions in place, so folk were not able to access services as they would do now. It's not to say, it's well documented that prison doesn't create good outcomes for people, and we do see people returning to prison who have previously served custodial sentences, but we are in a different time than we were the last time round. What we do have as well this time from taking learning from the COVID emergency release is really good processes that were put in place with partners about managing the lists, if we want to just call it that. So we worked together collectively, collegiately across a number of sectors to manage those cases. There was occasions we had a drug death that happened really quickly after release. There were a number of challenges, but I think local authorities and partners and SPS did reflect on the process last time round, and I think there is learning, and certainly the early conversations we've been having with partners within local authority, health and with SPS, we're already in a better position having that learning behind us.
So I suppose that was going to be my next question, really, just before I bring other members in, was obviously you had the sort of COVID experience, so to speak, and as you say, that there's been a hopefully in a positive sense, there's been learning from that. So I suppose my question is, do you feel that social work services, criminal justice, social work in particular, across Scotland are ready, or have had time to prepare for the proposed release?
So we're working at a pace, mm-hmm. So there's no getting away from that. I've got another meeting today with SPS to further have discussions around about the lists. Each of the establishment are setting up multi-agency groups to facilitate the release. We will have to take extraordinary measures to meet the requirements here, but there is a willingness to do that. We absolutely want to stand together with our SPS colleagues and others within the justice system to ensure that we are able to do this and deliver on this safely, with absolutely victims at the forefront. Yes, I think it's an additional ask at the moment on a system that's pressured like other local authority public sector services, but we have commitment. We had a conference yesterday, a Social Work Scotland conference, where the chief exec from SPS came along and Kat Dalrymple came along, and the spirit within the room was, we want to support the process, but equally we want to work towards getting more robust arrangements in place to manage the population going forward.
Thank you. Thank you for that. Okay, I know members will have quite a lot of questions, so I'm going to bring Katie Clark in and then Russell Finlay.
Thank you. And you've all referred to lessons learned from COVID and also referred to lists. So do you have a clear understanding of which prisoners are likely to be released, or what types of prisoners are likely to be released? And do you consider that it will be the least risky prisoners that are likely to be released and those that are most likely to not reoffend when they get out? And if I maybe go to Sarah first, whether you've taken a view on that, and I've heard everything you said about the long-term measures that are needed, but if you were going to go down this path, do you think the approach that's been taken is actually targeting the prisoners that are most likely to be appropriate for release?
I think it's really hard to say, because there's exclusions of who won't be released, but it's less clear about who will be released, except by time. Although, to that, I'd say releasing somebody a day early on their sentence, or even 45 days early in the sentence, it's sort of neither here nor there in terms of what their risk was on day one or day 45. And, I'm seeing now, with no emergency releases, that some of the releases, the way releases are happening, are not necessarily supporting a through care type situation. And one example I'm thinking of right now is somebody
who is coping with an addictions issue had a city mission worker ready to pick him up, to take him for a script and take him to his apartment and to buy that loaf of bread for his first night. The prison decided to release him 2 hours early without telling anybody. So he was back and lost into the system, and he was back in prison. So that's just the everydayness of the kind of risk that prison deals with. I mean, I do object to the sort of tone that, you know, preparing for releasing people who all are coming out anyway is sort of employing kind of metaphors I'm more used to hearing in terms of toxic waste, as if there's some kind of, you know, dangerous cloud that's coming out, and are we ready, and is it a disaster? I'd like to see, rather than focusing on risk, is what kinds of supports are in place for everybody who comes out, whether it's under emergency release or not. But in terms of the specific people being released, you can't really tell from the way the statutory instrument is phrased, as far as I can see. So I think it will come down to the judgment of the people who are closest to the prisoners, which is the staff working with them. And I assume they're in the best position to know after working closely with people who's risky and who's not.
But, I mean, are they going to be the people that are going to be making the decisions? I mean, it's a legislative process, so it's not going to be assessed by people that work closely with the individual prisoner, is it? It's going to be a more crude process. Is that your understanding?
Well, my understanding is that it's timed by your sentence.
Exactly.
Length,
so it's a,
but yeah. But there's a number on it, so it's being rationed. So someone's going to have to make the decision about, there's more than 500 people potentially who are within 90 days or whatever, 180 days. So there's going to be some rationing and decision making. There's always going to be some discretion at play, I would assume.
Thank you. I don't know if any of the other witnesses were wanted to come in. Kate?
Yeah, if I come in and then maybe Lindsay will add to it. So the process, as I understand it, is that it is based on time. Now, obviously, what's happened is they've doubled the length of the sentence time compared to last time. So it's a 4-year sentence or less, which does mean that there will be people who are in prison for very serious in cases, offences, who are on that list. However, there is, you know, there are a number of things that are being done, as I understand it, to look at risk assessment. Also, there's the governor's veto as well, which was included, this committee will remember, due to, in part, our lobbying on it. So governors will have an ability to veto if they think that someone is a risk, and that's very clear in the legislation around how they should determine that. So that that is my understanding about how the process will work. We obviously do still have concerns around risk and around the safety of victims too, and we do worry about the message that this sends, because Sarah's right, we know more about the people who are going to be excluded for the criteria than we do about those that are going to be included in it. But, you know, basically that's because my understanding is it's to do with just time that's left, the length of sentence and the time that's left, taking away the exclusions. So there will be, potentially people who've been found guilty of culpable homicide. There will definitely be people who have been found guilty of serious assault. Those people will be included in those figures, but there is, as we've just outlined, a process that's going on around, looking at what that list of people is, and then the kind of the criteria around risk.
So the list at the moment, so we've identified those who could be in scope, and those lists are currently, I think they're sitting with Police Scotland, who will go through the list to identify any concerns. The Risk Management Authority will also go through the list in relation to the risk assessment, and what will then happen is prison-based social work will then further look at the list to check social work records across local authorities. So what that will do is give more of a historical context of any social work involvement. It will also take into account any current social work involvement with a family, if an individual has a family or children. And we would coordinate, as we would normally do, with any other social work colleagues in relation to any concerns that might be around. That information will be then fed into the Governor, who will have final say on who's been released. So there is a number of levels of scrutiny that are being built into the system. And as I say, that because of the pace of this, that all is ongoing at the moment, and we're hoping that the meeting this afternoon, we can then start to scrutinise the lists from a social work point of view, but we have staff teed up in order to do that.
Thank you. Russell Finlay, followed by Sharon Dowie.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just to pick up on something Lindsay Smith said initially about when the early release happened previously during the time of COVID and the restrictions, I think if I understood you correctly, you said that the high reoffending rate that we saw then might be partly due to the fact that the support that might exist now wasn't in place then. Is that my understanding of what you said?
So there was support, and partners took extraordinary measures. For instance, there was lockdown conditions in place. And rather than staff pick people up, we were organising taxis, and we were organising for people to be transported to housing that had been put in place to try and make the transition as smoothly as possible. I think what they came out to was, you know, shops shut down, you know, communities not operating as they would normally do. Your GP would have been phone contact. You would have had contact potentially with your addiction worker via phone. You would have prescriptions that were getting picked up. So the key services were still operating because they were key services, but they weren't operating with... So a number of the recovery communities weren't up and running because they had...
Which might go some way to explaining the reoffending rate.
Yes, obviously, finding evidence to support that. But yes, it was a different time.
Is there not a flip side to that, though? If people were restricted in their everyday movements, they had less opportunity to commit crimes. And
I think it was so that there was still obviously offending. So there was restrictions, but there was still drug dealing going on. There was still a requirement to obtain funds to fund any substance misuse. So although you could argue that society was shut down and was operating differently, so, you know, opportunities to offend were reduced. But I think when someone is coming out and so isolated...
This particular proposal has been signposted for the best part of a year now. Just last summer, the governor of Scotland's biggest prisons talked about a catastrophic incident. It was a question of when, not if. And we've had a succession of senior SPS people issuing similar warnings. Now, in the letter that the committee received from the Justice Secretary last week, she said that the Scottish Government's working on information sharing agreements between the Scottish Prison Service and four prescribed groups, which includes your organisation, Victim Support Scotland. In your earlier answer, you said that you haven't even seen a draft of this. So despite the fact we've had a year of knowing that this is the direction we're heading to, your organisation and presumably other three organisations are still pretty much in the dark. Is that correct?
Yes. We've not seen a draft of the information sharing agreement. Certainly speaking personally, from my point of view, this process that's going on just now compared to the process that happened during COVID, we've had less involvement in that process. Last time round during COVID, obviously there wasn't a legislative set of criteria, but it became very clear to SPS colleagues very early on that index offence, so the offence that you're in prison for, in no way related to risk. So, for example, whilst we've gotten the criteria now that domestic abuse, people who are in prison for domestic abuse offences have been excluded, there will be a number of people who are in prison for other offences but who have a significant history of domestic abuse. So that's where the process that Lindsay's talking about becomes really important. But yes, we are concerned that the involvement of our organisation and others like us has happened very late in the process. We will not see the list. It won't be shared with us, is our understanding. We will have to request that information on an individual basis. And our concern around that is for victims who are not aware that the perpetrator in their case is going to be released, but we think that that will be, given the low uptake of the victim notification scheme that this committee knows a lot about, we are concerned that there will be very few people will actually know to come to us. We'll do our best with that, to ask if the perpetrator's going to be released.
So crime victims will see in the news that there's going to be a mass release of 550 prisoners who are serving sentences of under 4 years. These are, include people who have committed sexual crimes, acts of violence.
Well, the sex, if they're on the sex offenders register, they'll be excluded.
Right. They may have committed sexual crimes in the past, but index offence wouldn't include sex offenders. No. But other people who've committed acts of violence and other serious crimes. And at that point, they would have to approach one of your four organisations, not you collectively, sorry, I'm talking about Kate Wallace and the other three organisations, and ask for information, and then you would need to go to the authorities and ask for that information.
Yeah, they've got two routes. If they're already a member of the victim notification scheme, they will be able to go potentially through that route, and I believe that there is work going on to try and expedite that victim notification scheme process. They can join that, or they can come to the organisations that are listed, of which we are one.
Rough ratio of the 550, would you expect victim notification to be in place for most, some
no,
of these?
The take up of victim notification scheme is very, very low, as I think this committee have heard before. So, so we are looking at communicating quite widely with people to make them aware that they can come to us. But as you know, within the timescales, that's going to be extremely limited.
They come to you, but they cannot possibly know if their offender is being considered for release until they engage with you and you go through the process with them. But there is already in existence a list of the potential offenders, which is according to Lindsay Smith's in circulation with Police Scotland and the Risk Management Authority.
Yep.
Could the government be more proactive and share that information with your organisations?
Potentially, but that's not the way that the Act is worded, nor is it the way that the information sharing agreement, as I understand it, is being constructed. Because one of the other issues that I have about it is feedback from victims to inform the intelligence process around risk and potentially inform that assessment about whether or not someone should be considered for release or whether or not a governor's veto should apply. There's a missing step in that process too. And the timescales are not allowing for that. I'm waiting on Police Scotland to give me the contacts for intelligence just now. But it may be, for example, that a victim's been intimidated by a prisoner and is concerned about their safety on release. At the moment, there is no clear mechanism for how we can feed that into that process.
In a situation like that, the victim would be reliant on the police, who's looking at this information behind closed doors, to know that and to assess that the right way for them.
Yeah.
Right, okay. Can I just quickly ask one other issue that the bill, that what's in front of us, what the government intends to do, as well as the mass release, is the consideration of time spent on electronic monitoring bail. 2 days on electronically monitored bail would equate to 1 day off a subsequent prison sentence, or at least that's a sheriff would be required to consider that. This is something your organisation opposed and we attempted unsuccessfully to amend. So we know that there's up to 550 prisoners likely to be released early. But has the Scottish Government shared with you any sense of how many prisoners this measure might apply to?
No, I've not had any contact with government about that.
Can you give me any form of estimate or guess?
No, can't. Right. Not a clue.
Because one of our concerns was that this would incentivise someone who's on electronically monitored bail, they'd be incentivised to delay their court proceedings, causing further trauma to victims and witnesses.
Yep.
Because they knew if there was an eventual prison sentence, they would have been able to sort of chip away at that from the time. Is that still a likelihood, do you think?
I'm not close enough to it to be able to answer that question at the moment.
Right.
But we would share your concerns and other concerns around, we've got significant concerns about the effectiveness or not of electronic monitoring, especially when it relies on radio frequency and not GPS. But And our main concern about electronic monitoring really is that victims are left to police their own situation and their own safety and security. That's, you know, in this committee are well aware of that as well.
We use GPS.
GPS is a more expensive and potentially more intrusive way of monitoring. So presumably someone on bail has not yet been convicted of a crime, and it's about proportionality. I'd also say I'm not aware of any research evidence anywhere in the world that would suggest that people on electronic bail who are getting a potential good time or good cause or some kind of sentence discount are, that's incentivizing them to delay court proceedings. I've just never heard of that even as a plausible scenario. So I don't know if you've heard something or you've got some research evidence.
You would have concerns about proportionality of using GPS, though.
I would have concerns about the way that remand is currently being used in this country, where people are continuing to be held for long periods of time, and that they have much less access to programs and services, which they might have access to in the community. And I think, you know, Scotland's got a real problem with its excessive use of remand, and we see the suicide rate of people on remand being much higher than people who are sentenced. So in some ways, I think if we are concerned about the safety of people who live in Scotland, we'd want to be doing something to protect their safety through mechanisms like bail and not using remand in the way it's currently being used.
If electronic monitoring's been used successfully.
Members. Yeah. Okay. I will have to bring in, if there's time, I'll come back. I know that this is an important issue. Okay, Sharon Dowie and then Pauline McNeill.
It's actually going back on to the electronic monitoring. Lindsay, you had said earlier on that there's a marked difference when people get released the last time because we weren't living in COVID restrictions. Do you think the people that are getting released early should be in electronic monitoring?
Not necessarily. I don't know. I don't think so. I think no, because I think if we need to be thinking or considering about electronic monitoring bail, then they potentially shouldn't be in scope for this early provision. I don't think it's, you know, it's, we tend to use electronic monitoring in a bail situation to give, to if someone is, for instance, you know, getting involved in offending behaviour in the evening, we would maybe want to consider restricting them to their home between 7 and 7. To try and reduce that window, but also to give the court assurances that that a person has been closely monitored during that time. I don't think it's necessary because, as Sarah, Professor Armstrong has just set out, what a person needs is adequate support, housing, and services to be put in place to meet any complex needs that they might be experiencing. So for me, that's the most important thing upon release as part of this scheme.
Yeah. That's actually probably the next bit I was going to come on to. We already hear when people are getting released from prison that there's issues with housing, there's issues getting medical supplies, there's issues getting bank accounts, making sure their benefits and everything are all sorted. And there was also another comment that had come out from, I think, was it Families Outside? For some families, the return of a parent or other family member from prison is not always a positive experience. A lack of notice about the upcoming releases can make the experience even more stressful for families and in some cases may place them at risk of harm. So is there enough support being provided for the people that are going to be released early? Because we're obviously doing this at pace. And what are the concerns?
So community resources are really challenged across the board. Housing, we have a number of local authorities who have announced a housing emergency, so we can't get away from the challenges of resources. If we think about this cohort are going to be looked at individually, that there's going to be partners around the table putting in measures to support the release. That wouldn't have been so coordinated if they were to be released at their sentence end date. So they're almost getting what everybody being released from prison should get, that coordinated approach. So So in some ways, there's a huge amount of positives, although we're working at pace, that we will look to identify and support. So Kate had spoken about gate pickups, you know, to help that person, you know, make the journey from prison to pick up keys for a temporary furnished flat, for instance, or to go and meet with their addiction worker. So we will, alongside partners, coordinate that response. But we are challenged. The housing that is out there at the moment is not what you would choose for someone reintegrating back into society. But we will work to ensure that folk are given the best opportunity and that they will not be homeless, roofless upon release.
Will there be conversations that happen in advance to make sure that somebody that's getting released is not going to be released unless there is actually a house for them to go to? Because I've heard stories where somebody has been released and it's maybe 4 o'clock that afternoon before they actually know where they're going to stay that night. So will there be conversations to make sure that they will not actually be released from prison until there is accommodation, safe accommodation for them to go to? And will there be conversations had with family members if there is instances where family members would be concerned about their early release?
Yes, so we would look to build that in. If someone was returning to a family home, or even you know a mother or father, we would be looking to have the conversation with them about that return home. Again, that's something that wouldn't normally happen for short-term prisoners. But because of these measures and looking to support people back into the community, and anticipate family who were not anticipating, you know, a return to the home as early as would have been anticipated, then those conversations will take place. In relation to the homeless question, there'll be occasions, and quite a lot of occasions because of homeless crisis, that someone will be going to a bed and breakfast accommodation. So it wouldn't be, you know, on a lot of occasions, a person's own flat, a temporary furnished flat. So there will be occasions where people will go into a bed and breakfast situation.
And are you aware, when someone gets released, will they have restrictions on them? And if they breach those restrictions, will there be consequences, as in will they automatically go back into prison?
So there'll be no restrictions on them
at all?
Yeah, at all. But obviously, but there'll be support in place if the person chooses to take the support, but there'll be no restrictions.
Right. And you wouldn't support electronic monitoring? You don't think that's necessary for them coming out of prison at the moment for the early release?
I don't know what else it would add.
I'm just thinking we've already got a presumption against short sentences, presumption for bail rather than going into remand. So I'm just thinking about the consequences, thinking about a victim, thinking, you know, there's that person going to get out anything from, you know, a month to maybe 6 months early from prison. Whereas somebody who's at court could maybe be given electronic monitoring or a community payback. So these people are just getting released without any other penalty.
So if it gave a level of comfort, then I could see it being used as for that reason, or there is an argument that could be constructed around about that. But in relation to supporting someone in the community upon release from a short-term sentence, I don't think it's necessary.
Okay.
Oh, sorry, right. Have you got more questions? Okay, same. Thank you. Pauline McNeill, then Rona Mackay.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Got a lot of issues to wrestle with here and understanding the impact. Can I start with you, Professor Sarah Armstrong? There are trends in other countries that would show that we're imprisoning more people, although you highlight that Scotland seems to be at the top of the league table for many of these factors. So we've got longer sentences, but also continued use of short-term sentences, reduction in home detention, curfew, ending of automatic early release, and I think you said the Pro Board were slow at releasing people. So lots of factors there. Is it your view that these are factors that could have been known, or policy decisions that might have been predictable would have resulted in where we are now, exceptionally high population that we can't cope with?
I guess the short answer is yes. I think with the restriction of something like HDC, in response to an extremely tragic and horrible situation, is that you see that response has had an impact on prison populations. The ending of what was called automatic early release, I don't think that's quite the right phrase for what it actually is, should have been seen to have predicted that actually you're essentially doubling just about or adding a third of the time that people will stay in prison. So that, it's working out the maths is not too hard. So I think it would have been something that we could have predicted. The various presumptions against short sentences, that's had some impact, but when, one was first released, instead of a three-month sentence, it turned into a four-month sentence. And we are now starting to see even short sentences coming back up. So it seems like everything's geared towards increasing prison populations rather than trying to increase support or other things that we might be doing. I mean, it was interesting the point that MSP Dowie's raised about whether there should be restrictions on anyone leaving prison through this early release program. In some ways, we're all under restrictions. We're all under the restriction of not committing crimes. And if we do commit a crime, then there's a consequence for that. But if you add things onto that, like electronic monitoring and payback orders, that's a cost. So investing in that choice of restriction requires you take money away from something else, which might be something like housing. But moreover, I think it creates added ways that people end up back in the system. If you put them on electronic monitoring, which is typically with a 7-to-7 curfew, that we've seen in prior research, that actually can be problematic for people. It restricts their movement, and so one breach of that then is a strike and is likely to send them back to prison. So the more we set up these extra rules and restrictions on people, the more likely they are to fail. And instead of negative restrictions, it'd be really good to see some investment in positive supports and the kind of work that Lindsay's trying to set up, I guess, for this.
Thank you very much. You pointed out to the committee that the risk is the same if their prisoners are released 45 days earlier or whatever. But do you think there'd be an impact on the prisoners that may have been on any kind of programme within the prison in that time or not?
I mean, at the moment, the number of prisoners who are on a kind of programme is pretty small. And I think in some ways, the prison system is still in COVID. They still have restrictions and lockdown measures that were similar to what was happening in the pandemic. And the research that we've done on people in prison is that there's a huge amount of despair and hopelessness, and I think that's reflected in the rise in drug overdoses and suicides that we're seeing. So are they losing something? Are they losing something positive by leaving prison? I'm not sure I'm seeing that. And the kinds of programs that people might be doing in prison have equivalents outside, whether it's drug treatment or addiction support services or other kinds of services. We know those are likely to have a better impact outside of prison than in prison.
Thank you very much. Kate Wallace, can I ask? You said that you specifically mentioned culpable homicide as might be a category of prisoner that was released. Is that because of the sentencing around culpable homicide?
Mm-hmm. Sentences, as you're probably aware, for culpable homicide varies quite widely, and I think there is a possibility that there will be people who have been found guilty of culpable homicide in that cohort. And I suppose what I'm trying to illustrate is that the four-year sentence length is not short. It's not what I would determine as a short sentence. I'm not sure that members of the public would either.
I think it's absolutely true. So I've noted all that you've said around the lack of engagement with Victim Support Scotland, which is concerning to me, certainly. What would Victim Support Scotland want to see here in relation to making it safe for? So I picked up the points about victim notification and all of that. And I think Sarah, Lindsay had said that there would be some filtering out of certain offenders, because you made the point that even though they're in for one offence, they might have a history. Is there anything else that you think it would be helpful to do in filtering out risk to victims if this was to proceed?
Well, I mean, timescales, I think, make it difficult this time round, but ideally, and I suppose the first thing to say is that we agree that putting appropriate services in place for prisoners on release, the more you can do that, the less likelihood they have of reoffending, therefore the less likelihood there is of more victims being created. So we do support that. However, what we would have preferred to see is work taking place between the statutory agencies and the third sector in particular at a much, much earlier stage, so that mechanisms could have been created to help gather information from victims. And I understand what Lindsay's saying about social work having conversations around with families around release, where potentially there may be a problem. However, are those families going to feel able to say something to statutory services? We know that often they don't. I think there's been a key gap missed there around third sector organisations who are perhaps engaged with families and who may be better placed to have the relationship, I suppose, with families to be able to gather that information and feed it back into a process. But for me, running support planning and safety planning for victims alongside release planning for prisoners and having both with equal importance right from the beginning of this process would have been the best way forward. I spoke to this committee about that before when we were talking about bail and release previously. To me, that we won't be able to achieve that with the timescales and approach that's currently being taken. We'll do everything we can to help, and we've said that. I think that we need to be realistic here around that. And some of that will be around perceived risk, and some of it will be about anxiety that's being created amongst victims. As I've said before, we've already had increased in phone calls to our helpline. We knew that would happen. That was what happened the last time. But some of it will be more than perceived risk. It will be real.
Thank you very much. Lindsay, can I ask you, in view of that, it's kind of obvious that, so there's so many tranches. So the first tranche could be more than 100 prisoners, I suppose. Could be a figure. Is there a figure? Sorry, I forgot.
I don't think there's a figure yet for the first tranche, but it will be spread out over the four tranches.
We expect up to 500, so yeah. I'm just...
Yeah. Yes.
Right. Okay. So it could be quite a big number, mm-hmm. And given what's been said, every victim should be notified. But as Kate Wallace is saying, that's going to lead to anxiety for those victims, whether it's perceived or not, or real or not. Do you think it's possible for the first tranche, for every single prisoner to be identified with the support that they would need in order to make the public and victims feel?
So that's the intention in the work that we're doing at the moment, that we were able to identify those who are going to be released. They're going to be released across the country to different local authorities. The intention at the moment is that there is an assessment of that person's needs. So, for instance, if they have ongoing addiction issues, which continue to be present during their time in custody, if they're homeless, if there is any mental health, if there is any ongoing health issues, that we would be looking to put support in for each individual to support them upon for three integration, to link into community services. We also have mentoring services to have a bit of additionality support in meeting those appointments and attending any meetings that are required.
And you think that would require additional resource to do that? Because I think what you've said is that every single person on that list would be assessed for what their needs are. So.
I think there probably is additionality in it, but I think it's more in the coordination. So a person, being released today, if they had mental health issues, addictions issues, and were coming out homeless, would require all those services. At the moment, there is not good coordination ahead of release. So they will be accessing those resources. What we're looking to do is coordinate them.
Really important, which is all the intentions and services might be there, but it's a coordination. I mean, do you think that oversight, given the... Because when the public hear there are 500 prisoners in four tranches going to be released, there's going to be a lot of concern around that, but that concern could be I suppose, satisfied by the knowledge that each and every... should there be some kind of government national oversight, given it's going to be dissipated across all different local authorities? Do you think that would be possible?
So there is oversight at the moment, and so there is a government-led right. group. We're attending a group that's having oversight of all right. of partners.
So there will be national coordination?
Yes.
And can I just come in there, just something that you said at the beginning, that every victim will be notified? They absolutely won't. That is not... The process that's been gone through at the moment is not coming from a place of trying to make sure that every single victim of every single prisoner who's going to be released will be notified of their release. The onus is on victims to come forward and ask for information. And whether, you know, so we have got concerns about those people who will not be aware and who therefore won't come forward. And we expect that to be the majority of people. Given the numbers that we know in terms of low take-up of victim notification, and also, as this committee's highlighted, around the kind of lack of information about who it is that's going to be released, which I understand, but it was just to make the point clear that there's not a process running which is identifying every single victim in every single case, coming to each organisation to see if they can reach it. That's not the process, it's the other way around. Victims have to come to us.
Thank you. Hey, thank you. I know that, Professor Armstrong, you've got to leave just in at 10:25. I'd like to bring in Rona Mackay and just suggest that if you have any questions for Professor Armstrong.
I'd like to start with Professor. I know you do have to leave. Good morning. So my long-standing concern is about the number of women in prison and the number of prisoners remanded. You made some statements at the beginning about your concern about this as well. It's a long-standing issue. I mean, just in theory, why do you think that is? Is it because there's not enough support? Why are the courts remanding and locking up so many women?
I don't actually know systematically what the reason for that is. Mm. I spent a lot of time, because our research now is concerned with deaths in custody and the FAIs into them, looking at them, and a very sad case was the death of Caroline McLeod, who was so unwell she had to be wheeled into the sheriff, and the Crown opposed bail and he remanded her, and she sadly was from the court cell was sent directly to a hospital and died. So I think the Committee for the Prevention of Torture has twice come to Scotland and criticized its treatment of women in prison, and I just don't understand why, after both of those reports that were quite scathing, why it continues to happen. I think there's a lot of goodwill. There's a current evaluation of the community custody units in Glasgow and Dundee. I think there's been some issues with those. It's quite complicated because women are small groups, so it's many different sentences they're serving in those. But, you know, as the Ailish Angelini report so many years ago had said, is how many of these women need to be in prison, how many of these women are a threat to public safety, and how many of these women need some sort of treatment and support. I saw that Project 218 was shut down in Glasgow, and I think in an age of, you know, post-austerity, post-COVID costs, those are the first things to go, are the ancillary services rather than the statutory services. And that's a real loss that I think we're going to see the impacts of for some time to come. And I think that's true with young people as well, is what we're seeing is some horrific incidents of young people's harmful conduct. And, I see you have the prisoner governors coming in and the Prison Officers Association coming in next. And I will say one thing we know is you can't build your way out of this or staff your way out of it. I'd point out that in 2011, 2012, when the prison system again was over 8,000 people, they had 100 million less pounds in their budget, they had less beds, they had less staff, and there was half as many deaths in the prison system. So I don't think, you know, it's putting money into the prison system is not going to solve it, particularly for women in prison. I think that's a very concerning issue.
So currently there are 353 women, and 134 of those are on remand. Just for the record, is this emergency release system, does it affect remand prisoners? Or?
I don't believe it will go to that at all, which is why, in the opening
response, I suggested that really some of the answers lie outside the prison system itself.
Yeah.
I think when you see remands coming in for shoplifting, to me that instantly says there's an alcohol or drug issue there. And is there a choice there? Is there an opportunity there to do something different than put somebody in such an expensive resource?
Yeah. And just very briefly, I know you have to go. Do you think that the agencies and, let's just say, the prison and court establishment are working well enough together to solve these issues?
I'm really curious to know, actually, whether the courts, police and procurator fiscal are aware of and make any sorts of decisions on the basis of the capacity that different parts of the system have. So, I'm not sure.
Thank you. Thanks very much for that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. If you'd like to ask some of the members, and Professor Armstrong, we'll just let you slide out.
Uh-huh. Accommodating convener. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you for coming.
Thanks.
Okay, Rona, back to you.
Thank you. Kate, I wanted to ask you, and a lot of the exchange you had with my colleagues answered some of my questions, and you said the onus is on the victim to come and inquire about what support there'll be and things. Do you have any kind of sense of how many victims actually know that in a few weeks' time this is happening?
We know that when the Cabinet Secretary made a statement in Parliament that calls to the helpline and concerns raised to our local services increased at that point. So there has been some level of awareness from that perspective, but I've not got a sense at all at the moment of numbers. And what we've been trying to do is be really clear with all of our people about the criteria for exclusion, so that if somebody comes forward with that concern and the person is on a sentence of more than 4 years, for example, we know that we can alleviate some of that concern in terms of emergency early release anyway. So that's what we've been doing at the moment.
And how do you think are you able to reassure the people who will contact you or who have contacted you with their concerns? I mean, are you able to reassure them that they'll be safe?
Well, if there's perpetrators that may be on the list, we don't know enough to be able to make that to give that reassurance.
But if they say to you, that my offender could be amongst that because they're serving, less than 4 years. Can you say generally what support will be there for them?
No, because we don't have any information about specific prisoners and what's going to be put in place. What we would concentrate on in that case is providing support for victims in terms of their experiences and running and doing some safety planning with them themselves to help reassure them. So our focus would be on the victim situation rather than because we're not entitled to get any information about the prisoners themselves apart from are they on the list?
Yeah.
Well, if we ask a question, is that a specific prisoner on the list? We will get, I believe, a yes or no answer. Uh-huh. That's it. That's all the information we'll have.
And would you get a breakdown of the types of crimes that certain prisoners are being released?
Well, we'll know, but that's not my understanding. But if we have contact from a victim, we'll know from them. If they ask us if the perpetrator in their case is on the list, the answer comes back yes. We'll know from the victim about the crime.
Yeah, you'll know from
and
them.
And we'll also know from the victim about history, like Lindsay was talking about in terms of the history and the situation that there has been previously. As I say, index offence is not an indicator of risk,
potentially
in some cases.
Okay, that's interesting. Lindsay, I wonder if I can ask you pretty much what I asked Sarah in terms of, is there enough inter-agency working going on at this stage for this event that's going to happen in a few weeks? Is it going to be able to cope? That's really what I'm saying.
I think it is. I think there is. I see evidence. I'm part of interagency working nationally and locally. I'm head of service for Justice Social Work in Glasgow, and as a health and social care partnership in Glasgow, we're already meeting to look to ensure that we've got adequate resource in place to support it. The biggest challenge for us is housing in Glasgow. But no, I there is...
across third sector, across our statutory partners, there has been... Yes, we are working together.
That's fine. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
OK, thank you. We're just about up to time, but I've got a couple of members just wanting to come in, back in. Are you OK just to stay for another 5 minutes or so? Yeah. And I'll let Katie Clark and then Russell Finlay come back in.
I've just got quite a factual question to ask. We've got some of the figures in relation to prison population. And I'll ask Lindsay, because I think you seem to have the most information about what the government's planning and intending. There's been most dialogue with you. Do you have an understanding of the numbers in the cohort who could potentially be considered? So that's prisoners, you know, 4 years or less, that haven't been convicted of domestic abuse or sexual offence. Do you have an understanding of what that figure is? Because I don't think we've been provided with that broadly, is it?
My understanding is we're currently, I think there was, I think, so I'm not quoting figures, I'm talking rough figures in my understanding. I think there was around about 700 in scope initially, but taking out the exemptions, that then come down to 550, I understand. But that is then to go through further scrutiny.
So it may well be that a large number of those prisoners just are not suitable for whatever reasons. So is that, so your understanding is it may not be 500 or 550 that are released, it could be less. Is that correct? That's your understanding?
Yes, it could be. I don't think there'll be 550 because the governor veto will be applied.
Right. If there's problems in terms of capacity in the prison, won't there be pressure to try and reach as high a number as possible?
I don't get a sense from any of the conversations I've had with any justice partners that anybody is willing to take any risk. I think the pressure to alleviate, you know, the pressure to alleviate the prison pressure is obviously really significant. But I don't get the impression that any risks will be taken.
Mm-hmm. And if I could very briefly just ask, I mean, I won't ask the question because I think we are running out of time. So I'll just leave it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, no problem. Russell Finlay.
The committee's received a submission from Howard League Scotland about these proposals, and they say that this mass emergency release, and their exact quote is, will only be effective for a very short period of time. And they say that the Scottish Government's implementation of the emergency measures available to them in the Bail and Release from Custody Act, they're effectively cherry-picking. And they say that without implementing proper release planning and through care support, which they're suggesting is not happening, will only lead us back to more reoffending and the potential for another mass release down the line. So I suppose the question to Lindsay Smith is, do you agree with their assessment? And do you think, in all likelihood, that we might be here again?
So I don't feel qualified to answer that question, whether we'll be here again. I know that there's work taking place at the moment to look at HDC and the release of longer term prisoners. I think the analysis was that we could see the trajectory that we were on in relation to the prison population. But I think that the spike that we saw over that 2 month period was not predicted. So we are in a really uncertain time. That the backlog of the courts has still been worked through, which seems to be a contributor to this. But there is work, I understand, at pace, looking at other options, longer term, more sustainable options.
We'll be here again. Okay.
That is our concern. Our concern is that unless there's other work undertaken, that we will be here again. We've raised those issues, and you know, as I say, we have got concerns based on what happened last time. Albeit, I agree that you know we were in a COVID situation last time round, but yeah, we do think that there is a potential for that to happen again. And I think the Cabinet Secretary herself has acknowledged that, and which is why. She's looking at other measures, but as I say, my overwhelming concern is to make sure that we don't create more victims through the processes that we go through, and that we involve organisations at an early stage in terms of planning, so that that victims can be supported through this. The other aspect, of course, is trust and confidence in the justice system is at a pretty much all-time low. That's decreased dramatically during COVID, and we do have to take care, I think, around the messaging. And we've asked specifically around that in terms of public messaging, because it does send a message to people about who's been prioritised within the system, especially given that we know that there were more victims created the last time round.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay, we'll draw the session to a close. Thank you both for coming. That's been a very helpful session this morning. So thank you again. So we'll just have a short suspension to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you again. Okay, thank you very much. So our next panel of witnesses is Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, Chief Inspector of HMIPS, and Wendy is joining us remotely. Mr. Phil Fairley, Deputy General Secretary of the Prison Officers Association of Scotland. Ms. Paula Arnold, Governor HMP and YOI Stirling, Vice Chair of the Prison Governors Association of Scotland. And Mr. Ian Bryce, Legal Vice Chair of the Parole Board for Scotland. So thank you all for joining us and for agreeing to give evidence to committee today. And hopefully, Wendy, your connection will stick with us and let you come in. Okay, so I'm looking to allow around about 60 to 70 minutes for this evidence session. And I'll begin with a similar question to the one that I asked the first panel just to get the discussion underway. So as you all know, the Cabinet Secretary is proposing that we release up to 550 prisoners earlier than anticipated because of an emergency situation. And she's also proposing other measures later on via primary legislation to cover long-term prisoners. So can I ask, and I'll bring Wendy Sinclair Gibbon in first, and then I'll move from my left to my right. So I wonder if I can ask what your views are on these proposals. Will this be enough, or should an alternative way forward be found? And that in particular would be in the context of a sort of longer term approach around prison population. So if I can bring Wendy Sinclair Gibbon in first.
Well, good morning. First of all, my apologies for the intermittent network. I'm sitting in the middle of HMP Grampian, and there appears to be a problem in the northeast. Secondly, I just want to take the opportunity to thank everyone for the incredible pressure they're under, not only the prison service frontline staff, but also the prison service management, Scottish Government, the courts, the police, everyone. We are impressed with that. I think for me, the public and victims have a right to expect that when someone is sentenced, they are going to serve that sentence in a safe environment, and an environment where they're going to work hard to reduce the criminogenic factors that got them tangling with the police in the first place. Currently, that is impossible for the prison service to be able to manage the health, safety, welfare and rehabilitative commitment that I think we, the public and victims, have a right to expect. And that is because of the overcrowding situation. So I think there is a real need to have a crisis response, a short-term response, a more medium-term response, and a long-term response. And the planning for that should involve not only the prison service and all the other justice agencies, but also look at other agencies like scrutiny bodies, families, and third sector who work extensively with the victims and with the prisoners themselves. So for me, I think a crisis response is called for. And I think it's unfortunate that we're having to do it again so soon after the previous crisis response. However, as I said in 2020, if we think it's important for the judiciary to send all these people to prison, then although we cannot build our way out of a crisis, we should certainly be accommodating them in humane, rehabilitative environments. And that we're not doing.
Thank you very much for that. OK, I'm just going to move swiftly on and bring in Phil Fairley.
So I would agree with every word that Chief Inspector Prisons just said there in terms of, I mean, I think from the prison officer's point of view, we welcome the reaction to, it is a crisis response to what is a crisis right now in terms of the overcrowding in prisons. So something had to give and something, you know, needed to be done. So we welcome the early release introduction, but it is very much a short-term solution, and I hope it's the start of a series of things that need to come to tackle it more long-term than we're dealing with. All this is going to do is give us a little bit of breathing space, and not much more than that. We're not sure yet as to how many numbers we're going to actually see released, and I recognise and absolutely understand why the safeguards are there in terms of who cannot be considered for this, but it has an impact on the amount of numbers that we're talking about then. So that's right, and understand, you know, that we have to have those restrictions. But what we're going to get, I think, is a bit of breathing space and not much more. And it's for a short period of time as it stands at the moment. So there's much more than that needs to follow this up.
I wonder if you can just broaden out the impact. Wendy Sinclair Gibbon touched on it in her remarks. What is the impact on prison officers and staff? Because, you know, we know that they have a really important role in terms of relationships with prisoners and how that is being impacted just because of the practicalities of the situation that they are finding themselves in at the moment, and a lot of the time that they would have devoted to things like supporting purposeful activity is much more challenging now. But also in terms of their own welfare, so I wonder if you can just outline what your main concerns are in and around that.
So I think you'll understand that with the numbers that we're talking about, the prisons are hectic, busy, fraught environments at the moment. There's an awful lot of increase in temperatures, breakdown in relationships, and I think I don't think I've ever seen a chief inspector's report that hasn't made reference to the importance of the relationship between the staff and the prisoner population. It's what keeps prison moving. It's what keeps the place safe and secure. It's not numbers, you know. If you look at the numbers of staff compared to the numbers of prisoners, it's not a numbers game. It's about relationships and they've been able to deliver the needs. We're simply not able to do that. For the staff, for the first time in a long time, I'm hearing staff talking openly now about not feeling safe in the place of work for the first time in a very long time, or for some staff, for the first time ever. They're going in unsure of their position. They're not feeling as confident and competent and able to deliver what's required of them, and they're feeling pressures that some have never felt before and others haven't felt for a very long time. But they've been in the system. Some of the staff have been here 30-odd years, and they recognise some of the, you know, the clues and the cues that come about what's happening in terms of the atmosphere and environment. They're feeling a bit more threatened, a bit less close to the prisoner population in terms of those relationships, which are the things that keep things calm and ordered inside the prison. So all of that is starting to feed into the staff environment. They'll get into their work exhausted because, you know, they're just simply doing the daily routine regime inside a prison is what's stopping us getting to the bits that really matter to the public in terms of the end product. So their time's been taken up by that, but it's been taken up in a different environment now. There's a lot of niggles and fallouts and confrontation, not just between staff and prisoners, but between prisoners themselves, and it's the staff whose responsibility is to get in there and sort that out. So it's a different environment. It's a much more challenging environment for the staff. I think at the moment, probably 30-35% of our staff that are off with mental health-related illnesses themselves, which is coming from prolonged exposure to that kind of environment. I think, and you would expect me to say this as a trade union representative, but we've got a significant number of the staff who are of an older age group and who've been there for a very long time. So there's a natural impact that comes from working in that environment over a long period of time. To be getting to 45, 50, 60 years of age and being exposed to that now, is having a significant impact on their mental health and their ability to continue in the role. So the issue is twofold. It's you know, the ability to maintain those relationships and keep the prison working in a safe and secure way each day, but the long-term impact on staff is there's a drip-drip effect there that is not without cost.
Thank you. I'll just come to yourself, Paula Arnold, just for your reflections on what your view is on the current proposal around emergency release and perhaps a bit about longer-term approaches.
We're very supportive of what the Chief Inspector of Prisons has said. We're at a crisis stage, and that's why the emergency reliefs will give us some slight relief in the short term. What we should be working towards, though, is the medium term and longer term, and that's what the members of the PGA would be looking for, some sort of consensus in terms of how we move this agenda forward within the justice system. There is an impact on the prisons every single day. What has happened recently in the most recent upsurge in numbers over the last 2 months is what we see as the most challenging and complex people coming into our care on a daily basis, which staff and senior management are trying to cope with in such large numbers. And it's extremely difficult for governors, for deputy governors and for staff to meet all the needs of the people that come into our care on a daily basis because of the challenges that they face with the complexities that these people bring each time they are admitted into custody.
I'm interested in just you expanding on that. So can you, I suppose, give an example of the sort of activity that staff would normally support and assist with, that they can now, that is now challenging, if not impossible, for them to be able to deliver.
The extra numbers means that, you know, it means extra staff on different halls and landings, and these extra staff can not sometimes come from areas where purposeful activity is undertaking. So sometimes programme staff or staff that work in workshops are then deployed to work in residential areas. That means there's less purposeful activity for those in our care to attend to, so it's less rehabilitative programmes. It also means that when you are deploying different staff onto different halls, that, you know, those in our care will always go to the person who they know best on the flat, for example. So there's more pressure on the person who's the regular member of staff in that area. And there's also the staff that are there for the day, they don't know the people they're working with quite as well. And, you know, what the PGA are concerned about is meeting our statutory obligations on a day-to-day basis with the increase in numbers, but also providing some sort of rehabilitative work for people that normalises a prison regime.
Thank you for that. And finally, I'll bring in Ian Price.
Thank you. I think the first point to make is that, from a parole board for Scotland's point of view, these regulations don't affect us directly, insofar as that our remit is to make risk-based decisions on release, but that's mainly confined to long-term prisoners, and of course these regulations don't impact on that. In terms of short-term offenders, we do have some involvement, but that's really related to sex offenders, and of course they're also excluded from these provisions. So in general terms, at this stage, we're not directly impacted on it. What I would say, just to support what my colleagues have said already, is in dealing with the assessment of risk in relation to long-term offenders, it's become quite apparent to us that there are pressures within the system, and that can have an impact in terms of the availability of offence-focused work or community testing or things like that. So although this doesn't impact us directly in the short term, there is no doubt that it will have a knock-on impact to us moving forward in making the long-term risk assessments.
Yeah. Okay, thank you for that. Okay, I'll bring another members now, and I'm going to bring in Rona Mackay to kick things off.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. I wanted to start with just a kind of practical point about how the release will be administered throughout the prison estate. You know, so does each prison have a certain number that they can release and that kind of thing? How does that work? Does anyone know?
Assessment of risk in relation to the early release scheme, which every governor and their senior management team will undertake to look at the criteria which will be provided to us. So that whole assessment process will be undertaken with a number of colleagues and include working with partnership agencies to make that assessment.
Right, okay, that's fine. And Paula, just while you're speaking, I wanted to ask you about the Governor's veto and your thoughts on that. Can you maybe talk us through how you think that's going to go? Are you expecting to have to make big decisions in that regard?
The decision will be based on risk, really, in relation to, you know, protecting the public. You know, that's my utmost concern in terms of making sure that people that are released, and if it's recommended that a governor's veto should be reviewed, and that's what I will do. But, you know, my main priority is making sure that there's that the risk is minimised to protecting the public.
So who actually recommends the release to you then, that you then take the decision?
My senior management team will undertake that assessment of risk. It will be led by my deputy governor, and then I will have the governor's veto over that.
Yeah, and for the young people in your prison, you know, if you give the go ahead for some of their release, are you concerned about what they're going out to? Is there enough support for them once they're released?
The whole systems approach is very supportive of young people who are in custody, And I feel that the, I can only speak for myself and HMP Stirling, where there's very, very good supportive measures from especially social work, third sector and the National Health Service. I think that we work very, very closely as a team, and it's very much joined up working.
Good to hear. Thank you. Thanks. Phil Fairley, can I come to you, please? Can you say roughly how long this crisis has been in your sights, in terms of, you know, we've come to this now, this is crunch point, something has to be done, but has this been brewing for a long time?
So I think we've been operating overcrowded for a period of time, but I think when you get to the sort of 8,000 and above, you are getting into what's crisis territory. So we're talking about a matter of months now that's been coming. But to be honest, it's looked like the direction of travel for quite a period of time. So I think it's not come as a shock or a surprise to us that we are where we are. But once you get over 8,000, it's...
Yeah, so you're at the receiving end, really, of judicial decisions, I suppose. And do you think that there's enough recognition by the Crown about what's actually happened now? Do you think there could be a better culture, a better working relationship?
Yeah, so I don't think I'm overly qualified to speak too much about that in any great detail, but in terms of observing it from where we sit, you know, we just it looks to us every time that we create a space in a prison, somebody fills it. And just in talking to my own colleagues down south from the POA, there were over 600 released last week, but the numbers went up. 88 was the net outcome of that. So, you know, putting people out on, you know, emergency release powers to then immediately fill them back up again makes no sense whatsoever. It's not doing a thing to tackle the issue that we're dealing with.
Term, yeah, thank you for that. Can I ask one more question with Wendy, please? Good morning, Wendy. I was asking Professor Armstrong about the number of women that are being remanded and the number of women in prison and the long-standing issue that has been. So, actually, it may be Phil that might want to answer this, but I'll ask you first. I'm just wondering, with the number of not just women, but people on remand who may or may not be guilty, and they're not obviously part of this scheme, is there going to be some resentment amongst them that they, you know, that prisoners are actually, you know, getting out early and they've not been, you know, found guilty or convicted of anything? Is that a tension that's going to be there, or is that not something that's concerning?
When the last emergency release happened, I was concerned that children weren't given special priority in thinking, including whether children should be considered for release on remand. And I mean, there are legal methods that we have to adopt in order to consider that. It's not something a governor could do. But within that, I think we have to remember that when they're on remand, they are innocent until proven guilty. There may be some who are already convicted and serving a sentence on remand for another crime, but the vast majority are innocent until proven guilty. But in Scotland, we insist on treating remand prisoners as less well than convicted prisoners. The right to work, the right to earn a wage, the right to dental treatment, the right to attending you know, all purposeful activity is significantly reduced. We lock up the vast majority of remand prisoners for 22 hours a day, often in a cell designed for one, but having to hold two. And we consider that acceptable. It's quite astonishing, really. So, yes, I think there will be some resentment. There is, however, a kind of culture in Scotland that remand prisoners almost accept that they're treated very badly. So it is an interesting culture that I think is going to take some time to overcome and may allow for a level of complacence. What I must say is that in all our dealings in my tenure, I've not felt the level of tension that I'm feeling now, not only from prisoners, but also particularly from staff, a real fear that unless there are significant measures taken, that we are going to be in trouble. And there may be a resort. And if you look at the rising figures of violence and deaths in custody, then that's an indication that the trends are not positive. Yeah. I'm going to come back to, if I may, about the issue of we can't build our way out of a crisis. I think it's a well-believed mantra, or build it and they'll come. But if as a country we think it's important to have a very large prison population, then that as a country has to be either addressed culturally or we have to build to suit it. The level of aged care accommodation in prisons is very poor indeed. And so if we are going to build, we should be looking at aged care. And if we are going to build, we should be looking at justice centres where we align police, courts and prisons to reduce the amount of transport. So for me, I think we're at the crisis, but we need to do some significant medium and long-term planning.
Sounds like you're saying there should be a bit of a culture change in how we look at the whole issue and for long-term planning. Thank you. Thank you. Just very briefly, Ian Bryce, can I ask you in your position how are you feeling that this is affecting what you do in the parole board?
Do you mean in terms of the pressures on the prison system at the moment?
Yeah. Well, and also in terms of the decisions that you would have to make in normal times, do you know?
Yes, yes. Yeah. I mean, the first thing is that the parole board apply the tests for release largely which come from legislation. So we don't have wiggle room with that. We apply them as interpreted in turn by the courts. But then in terms of the how we do that, how we go about that, we get a very full dossier from Scottish Prison Service and that will carry all sorts of information that we need. In terms of what changes we're perhaps noticing or what's missing at the moment, there is no doubt that the waiting lists for offence-focused work are lengthening. And we're very often seeing long-term prisoners. It's important to make the point, I think, that although this is to do with the release of short-term prisoners, the longer-term prisoners tend to be the riskier prisoners from the public's point of view. And if we're looking at applying the test for release, we will look at various things, one of which will be, has someone done offence-focused work? And the offence-focused work does two things. It firstly can provide insight into the prisoner to help them avoid further offending. But what it can also do is it can provide information and insight to those who will then be asked to manage the prisoner in the community. So if people aren't getting the opportunity to do that sort of work, then that impacts on us in terms of our assessment of longer-term prisoners. And probably, if that evidence is not there, there will be cases where we might have released had they done the work, but if they've not done the work, we're just not satisfied that the test is met. Now, you also, another significant part of what SPS do is they facilitate community testing, and that will usually be after offence-focused work's been done, and people then get a chance to go to National Top End or the Open Estate and undertake special escorted leaves or unescorted day releases or indeed home leaves. Now, we are aware that there's pressures on that. There's pressures on that within Scottish Prison Service. I think they have some difficulties with the external escort providers, and that causes a great deal of, I think, disillusionment among prisoners and families who may have prepared for someone coming to visit and be escorted, and then on the day they're told it's not going to happen. And it also it creates an uncertainty elsewhere in the chain. So there are things that we will only release where we're satisfied that the test for release is met, but there are things that could be done which would perhaps better inform us in terms of whether someone does meet that test.
That's interesting. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you. That is very interesting. Okay, Russell Finlay, then Katie Clark.
Thanks, Convener. The Cabinet Secretary wrote to the committee last week to tell us that there's an information-sharing agreement between the Scottish Prison Service and four support groups for victims, including her own, which is Victim Support Scotland. And today she told us that even though we're now on the cusp of this being enacted and happening, that she's not even seen a draft of the terms and conditions. I know you're not representing the Scottish Prison Service, but I just wonder whether between your members, Mr Fairley, and your members, Paul Arnold, whether you've got any sense of what's happening with that information sharing, because I'm sure you'll agree that notification of victims is absolutely critical to this.
I don't have information about that at all.
Right, okay.
I'm sorry, Mr. Finlay, I don't have any information on that either.
OK, so just, I guess we can speak to Ms. Medhurst next week about that. Now, in your submission to the committee, I'm talking about the Prison Governors Association submission, you talk of the risk of more violence, drug-taking, deaths by suicide and drugs, mass indiscipline and loss of control. You make reference to prison riots in the 1980s and 1990s, and there was one line that really stuck out, and it said, and I'll quote it, these numerous factors, quote, can be the spark that ignites people residing in prisons to say no more. Now, that sounds to me like a sense of what you're trying to tell us is a very real threat of a return to those incidents that you refer back to. Is there not a slight risk in using language like that, that you're almost signalling to prisoners that they would be in some way, it's an inevitability, if not a justification for such an outcome?
We, on a daily basis, staff and PGA members work with really challenging people who bring lots of situations to the fore that we're finding extremely difficult to deal with due to the high numbers that's coming into our prisons on a daily basis. What we wouldn't want to see is a return to what most of the staff that work in the prison service now haven't worked in before. So the relationships that we see now on a daily basis are diminishing as such, because we just actually don't have the staff on a daily basis to deal with the high numbers. And we have a lot of recruitment campaigns going on just now. However, these staff have to get trained before they come into the prisons. So in terms of the higher the numbers, the higher levels of staff you actually need. So we don't want to go back to that. But in terms of using that language, we are probably in, as the Chief Inspector said, a situation where it is a crisis and some emergency response is actually required.
Another issue is the nature of those who are in prison. It's quite hard for the committee to be able to establish the breakdown and the types of offendings and so on. However, there was some research done recently which took a snapshot on a particular date, the date being May the 2nd, and it found that of the 8,220 prisoners in custody on that day, just over 74% were convicted or awaiting trial for violent crimes. And the research, and I won't go into all of it, but something in the region of 400 prisoners, to a very small percentage, less than 5%, were there for what, on the face of it, looked like minor offences, but we don't know the full picture or the background of the offender. I just wonder whether, despite everything that's been said about too many people being sent to prison, I think Mr. Fairley's on the record in the past saying the use of remand is ridiculously high, whether a snapshot like that, as far as the public's concerned, would suggest that this is actually proportionate and reasonable use of prison. Any thoughts on that? And it might be one for Wendy, perhaps.
Wendy, do you want to come in on that?
I'm happy to come in on that. I have a firm belief that there is a place for prisons within Scotland. I'm not an abolitionist under any circumstances whatsoever. And all you need to do is work in prisons and see the type of people that they have to deal with, complex, challenging people with significant violent records, mental health problems, substance misuse problems, to know that prisons need to exist. And I've said it before, your choice is stark as a country. We either build to meet the population or we don't, in which case you have to reduce the population and take the risk into the community. There is no question that for non-violent minor offending, that community alternatives are more effective in preventing recidivism. The research is there. There is also no question there is a proportion of people in prison who are severely mentally ill that staff have to deal with on a day-to-day basis. And frankly, they deserve medals. It is extremely challenging, the lack of spaces in the mental health estate for those who meet the threshold for inpatient care. It impacts directly on the prison. And there is also a significant number of people with significant mental health issues who don't meet the threshold for inpatient care but require intensive resourcing. And I think we need to accept that perhaps a different style of prison is required if we're going to meet the need of the people sent to us by the courts.
Okay. I mean, we took evidence as a committee last year in terms of pre-budget about the big picture about spending, and Karen McCluskey told us that 2.5% of the overall budget for justice goes to social work and 1.47% goes to community justice. So is it not therefore inevitable And she makes the point that if you want to do something differently, you have to spend differently. Is it not inevitable that we are where we are, given those ratios?
Do you want to come back on that?
Yes, I'd love to come back on that. Yes, please. It is inevitable, unfortunately, but it's not binary. It's an invest to save. We would have to invest in community alternatives and genuinely robust community alternatives that satisfy the public and also satisfy the sheriffs. And they don't exist at the moment. And that money cannot be taken out of prisons. We can't close prisons until that has begun to take effect and has public confidence. And so it is a difficult tension that to get the community alternatives we need, to get the prevention in place that's needed, that we cannot immediately take that money out of the prison budget. What's important in the prison budget is that we work intensively with the people in there to reduce the risk on release.
Thank you. I mean, have I got time to ask a quick follow-up question? There's a presumption against short sentences, in other words, a presumption against sentences of 12 months or less. That's been in place since, I think, 2019. However, according to some data we've got here, there are roughly 33 prisoners doing 3 to 6 months and 70 doing less than 1 month. Now, sheriffs have clearly been privy to the full details of those cases before making those sentencing decisions. Do you think the judiciary in Scotland are paying heed to A, that specific guideline, and more generally, the ineffectiveness of short sentencing as you see it? And that's for Wendy, I think.
Okay. My understanding was, because I tried to dig into this as to why people were having it, the day I looked at, there were 744 people with sentences of less than 12 months. Arguably, that would reduce the prison population dramatically if they weren't there. However, my understanding is it's more complex. These are not people who have turned up at court and then got a sentence of less than a month. These are people who've done significant time served while on remand. And therefore, this is the rest of their sentence being served, if you like. So I think I would need a more detailed breakdown and understanding of that to be able to answer your question properly. One of my major issues, and I'm going to use this opportunity to say it, is that we are not investing in post-release support. And I know there are significant plans in place to look at that. But when we release people homeless or into temporary accommodation, into bed and breakfast, you know, without the rehab support, the GP support, the personal person or support, looking at debts, looking at previous warrants, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, then in reality, we are setting them up to fail. And I think when we look at the long-term solution, we must look at an end-to-end issue. Why are they tangling with the police in the first place, all the way through to how do we help them stopping tangling with the police on the release?
And I think as well as that support, there's other measures that could be used or better used, such as electronic monitoring. And, for example, the use of remote alcohol monitoring, which is technology that's used elsewhere in the UK to great effect, but is still not being used in Scotland. Why is there this reluctance sometimes to embrace changes in technologies that might actually help alleviate the problem that we are talking about?
Can I come back in on that one
as
well?
That's for you, I think. Yep.
So two things when I worked in Western Australia. One was dangerous and serious offenders, and particularly dangerous and serious sex offenders who were released back into the community, were released back on GPS monitoring so that they could see what was happening, where they were going, there were restrictions where they could go. You know, if their trigger point is primary schools, they can't go near primary schools, etc. I thought there was an evaluation for that, which I haven't been able to track down, but it showed its effectiveness. Yeah. The other one was, and there was a big American study in that, and that's quite easy to track down, that GPS monitoring, which has got alcohol monitoring and sleep monitoring on it, and can be linked to a form of mobile phone that they carry so that they too can also ask for help, you know, showed where you've got disrupted patterns or alcohol there that can then be easily recalled. I mean, All of those are doubly effective if they also come with support. So for me, I think there is a real need to embrace technology in numerous dimensions. when we first introduced the kind of case management system electronically into prisons in England and Australia, there was a £4,000 a month saving on stationery. It paid itself off very, very quickly. You know, there are things like that, using drones to do perimeter checks, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. The use of technology really can transform our justice system in many, many dimensions.
I'd like to continue conversation, but I'm being told by other members. So thank you.
Back in at the end if there's time, but I'd like to bring another member. So I'm going to bring in Katie Clark then.
Thank you very much. And if I could ask Paula a question. I understand, Paula, that you're a governor at the women's prison at Stirling, is that correct? And you'll be aware that over many decades there's been a huge amount of concern about the numbers of women that we incarcerate in Scotland. So obviously these proposals are quite arbitrary. They will affect a number of women prisoners in Scotland, but it's pretty arbitrary, the cohort, if you like. More broadly, from your experience, what would you say is the proportion of women that you have in custody that you think really have to be there, that shouldn't be dealt with in another way? Or if you'd prefer, what proportion of women do you feel would actually be better dealt with in a non-custodial way? I appreciate, as you've said, you're dealing with very difficult people. I'm not in any way underestimating the complexity of the issues, but is prison the right place for some of these women?
I think other alternatives could be looked at, you know, in terms of what we could do in the community versus their risk. But that would have to involve a new type of risk assessment to ensure there was the community support there for people to live and be able to be supported in the community. You know, right now that assessment isn't there. People come into custody, they'll go back to court perhaps for court reports that have been commissioned for them. The care in the community might not be there, so they return to prison.
Thank you. I don't know if Wendy maybe would want to come in on that, whether that's something that you've given any consideration to.
I think for me, the stark reality of any women's prison I've been to in the last 6 years is how many traumatised and seriously unwell women are being held there. I understand that if there are very few alternatives for a sheriff to consider, at least they know they're going to be safe, you know, and I understand that. But I'm absolutely convinced that the vast majority of women could do with a better resource. Can I just say, I am so much in favour of the Scottish Government having built HMP YOI Stirling and the two community custody units. They are a leap forward in dealing with custody for women. I hope one day we'll take that same leap forward for men. But they are superb, and I just think that needs to be said.
Thank you. And clearly a lot of money has been spent on those facilities, so we need to make sure that they're properly utilised, but also that the women there really need to be there and that's the appropriate place for them. So obviously this is a fairly arbitrary proposal in terms of a particular cohort of prisoners are going to be considered. Could I maybe go to Phil in terms of if we are looking to try and cut prison numbers, the struggle that the committee has is knowing what types of prisoners are the prisoners that really shouldn't be in jail, that should be dealt with in another way? And I just wonder, in your capacity as a representative of you know, prison officers, whether you've got a view in that, whether you feel there's a proportion of prisoners that really just shouldn't be in prison and should be elsewhere, and how we categorise who those people might be.
Yeah, so I mean, I think I've also been on record before when I've said that the POA's position isn't we don't want more prisons, we want less prisoners. And that is because I think some of what we get sent into prison are a part of the population that there's very little to nothing that we can do with them that's of any great value to the public, you know, by the time we come to release them again. I think the untried is probably the most obvious example of that. When you look at them taking up about a third of the population of the prisoner population in Scotland, And as Wendy's already said, what we do with them while we've got them and untried is less, you know, than we do with any other part of the prisoner population. And the minute any resources freed up even from this process, it won't go to the untried population, it will go to the other bits that are failing and needing to be stacked up on. So for me, that's one of the population areas that we need to look at. Is untried really the only option we've got for managing that part of the criminal justice process? But the other thing that's really obvious to us now is the amount of prisoners we're dealing with who've got significant mental health issues inside a prison. Now, that's difficult for them at the best of times. In an overcrowded, hectic, you know, fraught environment for people with significant mental health issues that they've got in there, their condition's only getting worse and worse and worse, and that environment becomes worse for everybody who's sharing the same space. So I know the solution for this lies in investment elsewhere outside prisons, and those facilities don't exist, but that's why I think the prison service has been used as almost a dumping ground for, because we've nowhere else to put them stuff. And that gets in the road of us doing the bit that we really need to be doing, which is tackling the offender behaviour for those that are in for significant offences, doing significant length of sentences, and we've got them for enough time to make a difference with them during that time. That time is just getting swallowed up with churn at the moment, and I think we've got probably the biggest amount of organised crime gang members inside our prisons who are having a massive impact on what is happening inside our prisons day to day. So they're not. All credit to Police Scotland, they've had some really significant successes in the convictions that they've secured. So we've got some of the biggest names inside our prisons that have not stopped operating. They continue to operate inside our prisons. The impact that has on the environment inside the prison between settling old scores or fighting over turf wars, you know, for territory, for the drugs market that's inside our prisons. You know, all of that's going on at the same time where you're dealing with significant mental health issues. You're dealing with an ageing population. We've got a whole lot of prisoners now who've been in for historic sexual offences. Actually, it's social care provision that we can't provide there. Prison officers aren't social care workers, nor are we trained in mental health, you know, to manage that properly. So we've been asked to do an awful lot of things with a lot of people that were not qualified to give the proper service response that's required inside prison. So those are the areas that I think we need to be looking at. And I know the alternatives don't exist outside prison, but prison's paying a price for having to be the place that they end up putting them in.
Yeah, and prison obviously is a very expensive option. Yeah. I fully understand there's some people that have to be there, and you've outlined some of those, but the committee obviously is concerned about the individuals that perhaps could be dealt with in another way that's likely to be cheaper. Even psychiatric services may be a cheaper option. Is that something that your organisation is concerned about also, that it's actually a false economy, the way that we're dealing with individuals that go through the justice system at the moment?
Yeah, I think prison is a very expensive option, and it's almost a wasted, really expensive option when you overcrowd them and we don't get to do the bit that matters. So, you know, if there's a way of taking some of that out of the system and giving us the space to work with, we've got some really serious offenders and criminals inside our prisons that need to be there and need significant work done with them while they're there. We're not getting to do the work. And that, you know, so everybody's paying a price for that, but not being focused on by the system.
Thank you.
Very much. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you very much. Good morning. Could I begin by asking Phil Fairley and probably Paul Arnold want to answer this as well? So we know this is a short-term measure that we've been asked to look at. But in your view, Phil, what difference will it make to the management of prisons if we were to pass this legislation?
As I said earlier, I think all it's going to do is free up some time and human resource to allow us to start to do some of the bits that are failing at the moment. It's not going to make sea change impact in terms of what's going to happen inside the prisons. It really is just giving us a bit of breathing space short term. You're not going to see transformation coming from this change.
So the Howard League, the list of demands you've probably seen, which you wouldn't disagree with, things like, the big one is mental health support within prisons, so we're not going to be able to tackle that or provide any more rehabilitation programmes. It's simply breathing space. That's where we are.
No, I think that they would be regarded as a priority once we free up the resource, but I don't, given the numbers that we're talking about, I don't think we're talking about freeing up enough resource to make an impact that we'll be able to very easily identify the results from it.
Thank you. Paul Arnold, do you want to give me an answer.
All it's going to give us is short-term relief. As others have alluded to, the remand population is extremely concerning, especially across the Women's Estate, where it's risen from pre-COVID levels. 20% of those in custody in the Women's Estate were remand, which is now 37%. And that is just a constant revolving door for people in relation to admitting into HMP Stirling, transferring out to either Greenock or Parliament with women on a daily basis because of the high numbers of remand coming in. So in terms of the short-term relief that it will give us for those women who are convicted and may be released, it's certainly not going to give us any sort of relief for those women who come in remand and therefore have to get transferred within a very short period of time of being admitted into HMP Stirling, sometimes the very next day, for example.
Thank you. I mean, given what Wendy Sinclair Gibbon had to say about remand prisoners and the conditions that they're held in, have the prison governors got a view about whether remand prisons or remand centres are a way forward if we continue to remand as many people as Scotland has? There's a trend that doesn't seem to be relenting.
You could look at the fact, you know, the presumption against short sentences has been replaced with the increase in remand. You know, and that's probably how myself and fellow governors would potentially look at that situation, is what we've had is a decrease in the short-term population and a massive increase in the remand population. And then when remand go up to court for their sentencing, obviously it's backdated and they end up with quite a small sentence, as Wendy stated earlier on. So, but it's the remand population where we feel we have no prediction over what's coming in at night, you know, through the courts. You know, we can phone the courts on a daily basis and say how many are determined to be definitely coming in, and it might be two or three, but on a daily basis we can be told that it's anything between 10 and 40 possibilities. Mm-hmm. And trying to manage that situation on a daily basis.
Understanding what the prison inspector said about building your way out of this crisis, I mean, building more prisons, but I just wondered, do the prison governors think there's a case for... had been any discussion amongst governors that maybe we have to think about a different way to hold prisoners on remand? I'm really thinking about the conditions that they're held in, and I want to come to the question about why they're not included in the legislation.
We haven't had any discussion about the conditions or where remand prisoners should be held. It's been quite a tidal wave, to be honest, in terms of the massive increase. So we've not had time to discuss that as yet.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Wendy Sinclair Gibbon, can I ask? So remand prisoners are not covered by the legislation. I don't know if there's a legal barrier to them being included because of their status, but it kind of seems obvious that if we are prepared to release prisoners who are serving a sentence, in principle, to free up space, given the size of the remand population, is there a way around this? Now, the Cabinet Secretary was asked this previously to address this question, and she said that she would look at it, but it doesn't appear to have been looked at. I just wondered what your view was on that.
For me, I can't argue the legalities. I just haven't got that knowledge and expertise. But I'm very clear that we have very few alternatives, you know, like a supervised bail hostel, you know, all of those things. And so I think, you know, when we're looking at remand, we have to look at why they're on remand. And I think a review of people on remand that can be undertaken by the judiciary would be an interesting one. But the second part of that is a preparation for future years where we look at alternatives to remand, GPS monitoring, supervised bail hostels, all the things that aren't quite there yet. But when I talk to any members of the judiciary, they are fully aware that the prisons are overcrowded, and they're thinking very, very carefully about whether or not they should remand people, which is interesting. But one of the other things is we don't fund remand well. So if a prisoner on remand, the level of work opportunity and spaces and education is funded for convicted prisoners because of that anarchic rule that remand prisoners aren't required to work. Well, they may not be required to work, But the reality is, if they could work, they should be able to earn money to do so. Because by not being able to earn any money, it forces their families into poverty, because the family try and support them.
Thank you.
So I think the whole question of remand needs looked at every angle. If prison is the correct place, and if it's a heinous crime, it is alleged crime, then it is the correct place. But also, are there alternatives that sheriffs can use that would inhibit the number of people in remand? And, you know, there's the other side, which is if we can speed up the court process, maybe there won't be so many remand. We do need to look at the modelling of those that will convert to a long prison sentence.
Yeah. I was thinking more about whether there's justification for including remand prisoners in the tranche. I mean, if we're looking at a case-by-case basis with support for every prisoner that's released early and so on to make sure the safety in the community, why can't we do the same with remand prisoners to free up space?
I think there is a legal imperative that might prevent that, but we should certainly be looking at that and working with the judiciary to work out a way of managing that.
Thank you. And just lastly, Ian Bryce, the previous panel said that just looking at the number of reasons why we have such a high prison population, you specifically mentioned the parole board had a low number of releases. I just wondered, has that trend changed over the years?
The percentage of releases remain mainly constant. There have been fluctuations, and for example, at the start of the COVID pandemic, there were knock-on impacts in terms of people being able to progress to less secure conditions. There were knock-on impacts in terms of the prison operation and the availability of offence-focused work. But broadly speaking, the release rates have remained quite consistent over time. Now, just because I'm speaking just now, I agree with everyone who's mentioned mental health as being an issue, and certainly my view is that there is an overlap for a lot of people between mental health issues and offending behaviour. And I think if we could have a more joined up approach in terms of parole and, for example, mental health orders, compulsory treatment orders, if you know that someone's going to be treated for their mental health illness and you can enforce that, that in turn might allow the parole board to look at risk in a different context. The other thing is there was mention made about supervised bail hostels. England and Wales does have approved premises, which are premises which effectively people can be released to. It's for high-risk prisoners, and they are subject to curfews and subject to professional supervision and monitoring, really on a 24-hour basis. And while some things about the England and Wales system are not as good as what we have, I've got no doubt that that would assist us. There are undoubtedly prisoners who, if you had the availability of a place in an approved premises, they might then meet the test for release. But in the absence of that, and we really don't have that at the moment, the closest we have to that at the moment is the Dick Stewart project in Glasgow. And I think you'll be aware that, in fact, the availability there looks like it's going to be reducing rather than increasing, and that's really unfortunate.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because it's something that it's a service base in Glasgow, and I just find it really odd that a time where we need services like that aren't going to be there.
Well, from a parole board point of view, it can be quite a comfort in a dossier if we know that someone is going to the Dick Stewart project and has everything that that facility can offer, similar to Crane Services in Edinburgh.
Thank you. Can you just remind the committee, who's coming before the parole board, which prisoners?
We get all long-term prisoners, so that's everyone serving four years or more. And that includes the vast amount of people that we see. You can then subcategorise that. We have the indeterminate sentences such as OLR prisoners or life sentence prisoners. We've extended sentence prisoners both in the custodial term and thereafter they've been released and recalled. We have them in the extension period. I mentioned earlier we do have some small involvement in short-term sentence prisoners, but that usually relates to sex offenders, so they won't apply to these regulations.
But other than that, you don't see those serving sentences of 4 years or less. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can just stick with Ian Bryce for a moment. I was interested earlier on in your evidence. You spoke about sort of blockages on older prisoners, and access to some of the, and I did write it down, to some of the offence-focused work that is required for them to undertake, and important for you, for the parole board, in terms of understanding or in terms of your ability to assess risk. So I'm just wondering if you, what are the pinch points there? Could you just expand a wee bit more on what is it just as simple as the pressures of the prison population, or is there a wee bit more to that?
Well, there has, it may be that Paul actually is better placed to answer some of this than me, that there has been a restructuring of some of the offence-focused work during my time at the Parole Board. Now, that I think, has been a positive thing insofar as that previously there were issues, in fact, there was no work available in relation to domestic offending. But what we have now is we have the self-change programme, which is there for violent and sexual offenders and can bring in the serious domestic offending that we see. So the transition to that perhaps has been a bit of a pinch point. But what I would say is that the starting point for all of this was always that the prison would undergo what's called a generic programmes assessment. And that was when professionals would come in and have a look at the prisoner, have a look at the offending history, and work out what courses he needed to do. And thereafter, once that assessment was carried out and approved by the risk management team and the programmes case management board, they would then go on a waiting list for the programme. Now, I think when I started at the parole board, the GPA was the easy part of it. That was done very quickly. And thereafter, people would go on waiting lists for programmes. What I am noticing now is that there is not only waiting lists for programmes now, and those waiting lists are years sometimes at a time. But what I'm now noticing is there are people on waiting lists for the GPA itself. So not only are they waiting to do the programme, they're waiting to be assessed for what programme they actually need to do. And in terms of the evidence that we take, or the submissions that we hear from solicitors, it's often submitted to us by solicitors. The prisoner won't have time to do the course before their sentence end date or their earliest date of liberation, so you should release them. Now, that's not always the best of arguments, because if someone doesn't meet the test for release because they've not done a course, then I think from a parole board point of view, that's the end of our role in that. But what I would say is that we're now having that submission made for prisoners whose date of liberation is perhaps 2 or 3 years from now. And it is hard to work out what's going to happen to that prisoner if we're being told they're not going to be able to get to do a course in the next 3 years. And that doesn't, again, just impact on the offender, it also impacts on the public. Because if someone then gets to their earliest date of liberation or sentence end date and hasn't done that work, then that risk goes out into the community with them. So there are real issues there.
Do you feel that there's scope for that whole policy process to be reviewed?
Well, I mean, I'll defer to Phil and Paula here. I mean, my impression is it's a kind of boots on the ground thing. Mm-hmm. You know, if you have four facilitators, they can do the work of four people. But if you've got a long waiting list, what you need is more facilitators. And I understand the pressures the SPS have at the moment.
That's very helpful. Thank you. OK, I'm going to bring in Sharon Dowie.
Just to come back to Paul Arnold, just for the governor's vetoes, I was just wondering if you could maybe tell me what kind of circumstances you see governors using the actual veto. What I was thinking was, it's obviously for prisoners that we feel are going to be a danger, but the people that are getting released are people that are on a maximum 4-year sentence. By the time they actually get released, it'll be somebody that's it's a maximum 5 months that they'll probably be getting out early. So I'm just wondering what circumstances you see them getting a veto, because I would have thought they would have been near the process of being released at the end of their sentence. And would they automatically get released, or is there occasions where you would actually keep somebody in prison for a reason? Do you not think they're ready to get back out?
The tranches will be released anyway in the period that they should be released in terms of their liberation date. And, you know, when I was the governor of Lomas during the last early release, I think there was only two governor's vetoes that I signed off. So it was looking at the circumstances that were recommended to me that at this point in time, this person wasn't suitable without the pre-planning that would be in place for this person to be released so quickly. So, for example, there might not be an involvement with third sector or through care services or somewhere for that person to live, or mental health might not have been in place for the support for them, or drug and alcohol. So it's very kind of person-centred in relation to if a governor's veto is required based on, and it would be based on that risk of that person, and the recommendation would come to me, and that would be what I would look at. But as I say, there was very few numbers when I was a governor of Lomas that I actually vetoed against.
Right, OK. And it says in it that if you think that it would pose an immediate risk of harm to a specified individual or group of individuals if released, how would that information come to you?
It would come in an assessment. It would be through the Deputy Governor would lead on the early release scheme. Case by case, people are reviewed, and what you'd be looking for is red flags in relation to potentially why not, when they meet the rest of the, when they meet the criteria, what red flags are there potentially why that person should not be released.
So if you're not happy with the planning, then you would use the veto for that?
Yes, definitely.
Right. Okay, that's fine. The other thing I was going to ask you was, you stated your concerns about the increased prison population resulting in greater violence against staff and drug-seeking, taking behaviour. What more should we be doing just now to ensure that drugs don't enter the prison estate? Because that seems to be a huge issue at the moment. What more do we need to do now to stop drugs entering?
There's various methods that are in place at this moment in time to circumvent drugs coming into prison. You know, there's new body scanners within the majority of prisons that have just been installed of late. So I think that, you know, with the investment of what Scottish Government and the SPS have done already, we are doing as much as we can. But it is about, you know, being highly observant in terms of, you know, people who potentially could traffic drugs, and how, you know, there's drones coming in, flying over prisons, depositing drugs as well. So there's some probably more investment in technology required to be looked at in terms of how we modernise and find out how we can stop drugs coming into prison.
How long have the body scanners been in use for?
Well, since HMP Stirling opened, the body scanner has been there, and they've most recently been implemented across Scotland in the majority of prisons, so I would say in the last year.
Drug dogs?
Yes, there's certain teams that are dispersed across the whole of Scotland with search teams, which include dogs.
Right, so they're not based in a specific prison?
They're based in regions, is my understanding. So prisons would have shared responsibility for the tactical dog search and teams.
Okay. And one thing that there's a few comments you have made about, it's a breathing space and not much more, and it's been mentioned a few times about having medium and long-term plans. Have those medium and long-term plans been written down, and are you in discussion with the Scottish Government with them? So do we have a medium and long-term plan? Because we've obviously this is just a breathing space. So what are we going to do to improve this for the future?
So when I made reference to the medium to long-term plans, it wasn't in relation to any conversation that's gone on anywhere. It's simply an observation from where we sit that actually this should only be the start of what needs to be a much bigger, wider conversation about where we go from here. It's only ever going to provide that very temporary relief, and it has to be the beginning of something else that's much bigger than that. Otherwise, we will just keep coming back to this position.
So at the moment, there isn't really any medium or long-term plans to fix it ongoing?
But all I can say is not being shared with us. It's not a conversation that we're involved in. It might be going on elsewhere, but not with us.
Right, OK. And just one question for Wendy Sinclair Gibbon. Some of the things that have been talked about is obviously looking at the whole system to see what we need to improve on or change. And we've mentioned like supervised bail hostels, remand centres. I suppose I don't know whether I would describe it as a secure care home for some of the ageing population that have got quite a lot of health needs, and maybe a secure mental health for those that have got severe mental health problems as well. Is that something that's just getting talked about, or is anybody in discussion with the Scottish Government? Is that something that they're actually taking action on?
I think I'd have to echo Phil Verley. If there it is something that they're taking action on, I'm not aware of it. I haven't seen any written plans or any action planning out of it. I am aware that we've had discussions because I've been raising these issues for some time. So, yes, I've sent them the information about the prison in Victoria called Ravenhall, Victoria, Australia, which has a joint unit run jointly by the Forensic Health Estate and the prisons. I've talked about halfway houses and bail hostels and supervised bail hostels and the evidence in favour of those, so, and GPS monitoring, but I haven't seen any written down plans or action plans.
Thank you. And just one last question, I don't know if you'll be able to answer it. We've obviously got the presumption against short sentences, presumption for bail, etc. But you also mentioned earlier on about how there is now an increased remand population. So has that worked, or has it just moved people from having short sentences to repeat offenders that eventually end up in jail on remand for sometimes quite a substantial amount of time before they're actually seen at court? Do you think it's working? I don't know if you want to comment on it.
I think it's important to look at the historical evidence. And during COVID, we had an emergency release and the lessons learned from that. And one of the things that didn't work was it didn't reduce the population overall for any significant length of time. Here we are at an even greater crisis in terms of population, not in terms of health. So the impact of whether the COVID has had a backlog in the courts, which has meant an extended level of remand, I haven't done the analysis of that. I'm afraid you'd have to direct that question elsewhere.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else, any comment? No.
Okay, thank you. I wonder if I can just come in with a couple of final questions. So the first one is more a practical issue around the actual release process. And we know that the plan is that there will be four tranches of release. We're not sure what the numbers will be. And obviously that's applied across the across Scotland. And I think somebody perhaps anticipated that obviously some prisons will have more numbers-wise than others. We've spoken a number of times about the sort of lessons learned from previous release processes, not least of all during COVID. So I wonder if I can maybe come to maybe Paula and Phil. On the back of previous sort of experience around release, What's your view on perhaps what needs to be put in place, learning from previous experience, to make the process of release as sort of smooth as possible, but also importantly, to kind of minimise the likelihood that somebody comes back into prison, i.e. through reoffending? So are there particular arrangements that you feel are really key to have in place so that release process, I suppose, causes the least disruption to the function of prison, the prison estate. So maybe come to Paula first on that.
Well, I suppose I can speak from when I was Governor of Lomas and people were released then. And at that point in time during COVID, it was quite difficult because of the health concerns. And we still managed to do that and work with partners, NHS, mental health services, addiction services, and a lot of third sector. So there was a lot of pre-planning, even although it was very, very quick that we had to do this. There was a lot of joined up working. Was really grateful as the Governor of Lomas to make sure that we knew that people were going out with a plan, and that was the most important thing. It was a very hurried plan, but at least it was a plan and it was an agreed plan, and we knew where people were going. We even knew what bus they were getting on, sometimes what train they were getting on. The route was made out for people and how to get home, for example. So sometimes it's just the basics in terms of how someone's going to get from a prison to their home is fundamental, really.
Okay, thank you. Phil, do you want to come in on anything around that?
Yeah, so, well, I think through the COVID release, we were releasing for entirely different reasons and looking to try and keep prisons as safe as possible we could. But I think if we're going to learn anything from this at all, it's making sure that the risk assessment process that we're using is properly assessing the risk. I don't just mean in terms of whether that person's a threat to their previous victim or likely to re-offend, but it's actually what we're releasing them to. I think feedback that we've got from our colleagues down south is people being released under this scheme without an address to go to. So it's what we're releasing them into. If they don't have a home to go to, if the family background situation is one that's not conducive to that early release, all those things need to be factored in, or we are going to have them coming back again. We're going to let them out the door and they're going to come back and have them re-offended. So it's really about the risk assessment process, Capturing all that needs to be captured, not just the offending behaviour, but the environment to which they're going back into and whether they've got somewhere to go.
Yeah. OK, thank you. I mean, just bearing in mind, I'm just looking at the update from the Cabinet Secretary, and I think the first tranche is due to be released on the 26th of June, so it's not long ago away for some planning to be put in place. I wonder if I can finally ask about an issue that we haven't covered, and that is access to healthcare in the prison estate. And I know that can be challenging at the best of times, but I'm interested in what impact the significant rise in the prison population has had on the provision of healthcare. Again, I'll maybe come to Phil and then back to Paula and Wendy if there's anything you want to add.
So access to healthcare is a significant issue for the population inside our prisons, and we've talked earlier about the importance of the relationship between staff and prisoners. There are certain things that will impact the environment and the atmosphere inside a prison simply by being able to get access to it or not getting satisfactory access to those things. Probably one of the biggest things is healthcare. Prisoners worry, if they've got a health issue at all, it's magnified for somebody who's inside a prison in that enclosed environment, and it becomes a bigger worry sometimes than it needs to be, but it's real for them. And not getting access to that and what they believe is a timely fashion or in a way that gives them access to the services they need adds to that temperature and the hostility and the anxiety that just surrounds the air inside the prison when that's one of the areas that prisoners feel they're not getting proper access to that. So it does has an impact right across the board, actually. There's lots of things that they get frustrated about. Health is something they worry about, and if we don't give them access to that, the level of reaction to that is much more increased.
Thank you. Paula, do you want to add anything on that?
I'll just say I agree with Phil on that, in terms of the mental health of people in custody is magnified, and they know that themselves. It's not something that it's just apparent to the staff or to the management teams. People understand that. They're probably withdrawn from drugs or alcohol. They're in a different sort of circumstance, so it's magnified in terms of their own health needs is more apparent. So, and it become quite fraught when people have put their name down for, they want to help themselves, in terms of being listed for drug and alcohol services or to see a mental health nurse, and it just doesn't happen quick enough. There's then retort between the staff, the prison staff, and the person in our care. So it can be quite a fraught time if there's just not enough staff to go around to help that individual.
Wendy, do you want to? And I know you look at this very, very closely. Just any final brief comments?
Healthcare is one of two of our top concerns in terms of what prisoners write to us about. There is no question there are insufficient staff. It's an inconsistent, patchy application. What Forth Valley NHS manages is not what Tayside manages, not what Highland manages. So it's a difficult one. But I think in reality, we have to recognise that you can't have bespoke healthcare. You ought to have bespoke healthcare. It cannot be a principle of equivalence because they're in prison. If you can't make an appointment in prison, or you can get a car, you can get a taxi, you can get a friend to take you in prison, you can't. You have to rely on GOAME, and they fail routinely. But what we see is that the pressures in the NHS, in the community, are replicated and exacerbated in the prison, of which I agree with Paula, mental health stands out. The difficulty of recruiting sufficient mental health nursing staff to support the mental health needs within prison is just so obviously lacking. Yeah, okay. So, yeah.
Thank you, Wendy. I know Russell Finlay wants to come in with a very quick final question.
It was in relation to something that was said earlier, but overlaps with prisoner mental health, and that was the absence rates that were mentioned for SPS staff. I think it might have been Paul Arnold that provided a number, a percentage. Is that something, or is it Phil Fairley, perhaps? Sorry. Right. Do you happen to have that number to hand?
So it fluctuates at the moment between 30 and 35% of the staff absences that are off at the moment are off the mental health issues themselves.
Right, I see. I thought I misunderstood. I'm glad I clarified. So it's 35% of those who are off at a typical moment is relating to mental health.
Of those that are off, yes.
Oh, yes, indeed. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, we'll close this session. Thank you very much. Thank you, Wendy, for coming in online in the middle of your inspection. Thanks, everybody. That's been really informative. So we'll just have a short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave. Thank you again. Okay, thank you, members. Our next item of business is consideration of the following negative instrument. That's the Sheriff Removal from Office Order of 2024, SSI number 148 of 2024. And I refer members to paper 2. So can I just ask if members have any questions on the instrument, or are we content with it? Russell Finlay.
Yes, a couple of questions. Thank you, Convener. Now, I've been assisting one of the female complainers in this long drawn out saga, and there are several questions and concerns. And I think it's useful just a very quick synopsis of what this is about. This is the first ever fitness for judicial office tribunal in Scotland, having been legislated for in 2014. And in March 2021, the tribunal found this individual's behaviour to be inappropriate. However, the findings of that tribunal were quashed on appeal because the tribunal did not take some other evidence into account, and a second tribunal was held which ruled that he'd committed serious and proper conduct, which is a matter of public record. Now, all of this took 5 years to conclude, and in that time, the individual was suspended in full pay, which amounts to not far off £1 million in pay, and the public, as far as I understand it, also may be required to pay the legal costs of this individual. Now, I've asked the Scottish Government how much this will be, and I'm waiting for an answer. But the first question I'm proposing the committee might be interested in asking is it proper in circumstances such as these for the public purse to meet the cost of a judicial office holder's legal fees? And the second question is in relation to the time this took, whether what appears to be a relatively straightforward process that you might imagine happening in any other walk of life, why that took the best part of 5 years, and just wonder whether, on the basis of this being a brand new tribunal and a brand new process, whether Scottish Government is concerned that this case is going to be typical, or whether they're confident that we won't see a repeat of a five-year process. And the third point is a possible question, more of a general point. But the female complainer in this particular case was led to believe that she did not have an automatic right to know the outcome of these proceedings, and indeed that wouldn't be automatically a matter of public record. It's at the discretion or the behest of the First Minister of the day. Now, in March, I wrote to the First Minister at the time, Humza Yousaf, suggesting that this might be looked at. I wouldn't necessarily call it a loophole, but whether there should be some form of appraisal as to whether in a tribunal like this, as rare as they might be going forward, whether there should be a default position whereby complainers certainly should be informed proactively and unconditionally, and indeed the wider public. So that's my thoughts.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, do any other members have any other comments? No? Okay, thanks for setting out those points. And what I would propose is that the committee writes to the Cabinet Secretary and raise these points and ask for some response from her on the particular issues that you've raised.
Because it's in everyone's interests that this process can be trusted, both in terms of the judicial office holders and indeed the potential complainers.
Yeah. Okay, that's in order. Okay, thank you very much. So that completes our deliberation of the SSI, and that concludes the public part of our meeting for today, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.